God bless you all in the mighty name of Jesus. You're all welcome in Jesus' name. And of course, we know that today is another day in the presence of the Lord. It is Jesus' sanctuary hour. And like I always say, we're always happy to be in your homes. And we know that God will bless us all mightily indeed in the mighty name of Jesus. Like I said yesterday, Pastor is not around because of the program in Padova that's starting tomorrow. And those of you who are in the area, Padova is in Italy, for those of you who don't know. I just encourage you to go for that program. It's always been a wonderful program anyway. And I know that this one is going to be a great program in the name of Jesus. So if you're in the Italy area, if you're anywhere else too, even here in London, in the UK, in Europe, because I know there are people who are going for that program from other parts of Europe, make it a date, you know, to be in the presence of the Lord just for this weekend, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. And I believe you will testify in the mighty name of Jesus. The theme of the program is Arise and Shine. And of course, you will see that in Isaiah chapter 60, verse 1. It says, Arise, shine, for thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. So this is the time for us to not only arise, but to what? Shine. This is the season of arising and shining. And we know that because this is our season to arise and shine, as we arise, anything we set our hands to do, we shall definitely prosper in it, in the mighty name of Jesus. And there was a message that Pastor said I should give unto you to, you know, yesterday. I will repeat it today for the benefit of those who didn't listen in yesterday. He said, because on Wednesday service, yesterday's miracle service, like I said he didn't even prepare, but there was something that God was just, you know, ministering to him as he was preaching. And he said, I know that he has never seen it in that particular way, and that he's going to, you know, talk a lot about it. And he said, I should tell those of you who are going for the program in Padova that tomorrow being Friday, the first day of the program, he's going to speak on hand. And, you know, he said that because the ministrations and the rhema he was getting concerning that hand, it was something else. Now, that's the first thing, because if your hands are tied, you cannot arise and shine, obviously. Once somebody's hands are tied and people's hands are tied, your hands may not be tied physically, of course, but we're talking about spiritually speaking, people's hands are tied. And when somebody's hands are tied spiritually, the person can't progress. No matter what they try to do physically, no matter the efforts they make, because their hands are tied, they are not making any progress anywhere. Some people's hands are tied, even in their marriage. You see women who will do all they can to make their marriage successful, yet the husband doesn't even want to know. And vice versa. The man may be such a wonderful husband, the kind of husband that any woman would dream about and wish to have, but yet, you know, no matter what he does, no matter how much he takes care of his wife and shows love, it's like he doesn't even touch the woman at all. Instead, she becomes more and more a problem. Some people's businesses too, they have the knowledge, they know they have the wherewithal. Maybe they even went to do some training or some, you know, degree or whatever for that particular business. But they come out and nothing. There are people who come out as doctors, set up hospitals, but they don't do well in life. And there are some doctors who may not even have specialized in any particular area, but they are doing so well. There are people who you feel that have a lot of opportunity, they're intelligent, they, you know, have a good education, they come from a family that has a lot of connections, but somehow or the other, with all these advantages, they don't seem to be moving forward. Not because they're lazy, not because they lack one thing or the other. In fact, they seem to have it all, but yet things are not turning out well because their hands are tied spiritually. So that is the first, you know, that is the first thing that Pastor said he's going to handle in Padova. So make sure that you don't miss that program, because every chain and every padlock, whatever the enemy has used to tie your hands in your finances, in your business, in your future, in your destiny, the hands of your children, God is going to destroy those chains in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen. And he said equally to that, on the 26th of April, which is our Passover night, we are going to, that is going to be the theme of our Passover night is going to deal with hands too. So if you're in the area in around Old Kent Road, make sure you make a date with that program. It's on the 26th of April. It starts by 10 p.m., the last Friday of the month. And he said that we're going to deal with hands. Every, you know, where our hands have been tied, every satanic hand upon our lives and so on and so forth, God said that he's going to what? He will destroy it. So that is what Pastor said, and that's the message. And yesterday, I just touched on that hand because that's what he wanted me to say concerning that hand, so that you have a taste. Some of us don't realize how important our hands are, and that Satan uses all sorts of things in order to, you know, tie people one way or the other. There are things that people don't know for years and years and years. It's not a lack of prayer. It's not a lack of, you know, fasting. It's not a lack of, you know, walking in holiness and righteousness. But there are things which we need to know, because God is a God of principles. And we need to know that God is a God of principles. And once those principles are there, God will you know, obey the, you know, he will walk according to those principles. So we need to know some of these things, and we need to find out from God what is going on, what is happening, and he will direct us. It was God that revealed the issue of hands to Pastor. He didn't just dream about it. And as he was talking yesterday, there were a lot of things that were coming forth. So we thank God for revelation. We thank God that, you know, God, you know, revealed it for us, because God reveals things to us so that, you know, we'll be delivered and that we will prosper and, you know, things will go well with us. Praise the Lord. Mm-hmm. Well, before I continue, I just want to, you know, I want my sister to see. Yesterday, you didn't see her, but today she's here. She was just indisposed for a while, but she's here today. And I just want her to speak into the life of those of you who are watching. Yes, my sister.
Good evening, viewers. We welcome you once again to Jesus Sanctuary Ministries Hour. We thank God for what God is using this program to do in your lives, in your homes, in your marriages, in your situations, even in the lives of your children. We thank God because we know that God has ordained this ministry to be an end-time ministry. And that is why the anointing of God upon the servants of God, the Pastor Ozo and Pastor Mrs. Ozo, the anointing is really the anointing, an end-time anointing. And people are being delivered, people's eyes are being opened to what the, you know, the plus and plan of the enemy. And once you know the truth shall set you free.
Amen.
And you're welcome. And please stay tuned in Jesus' name.
Amen. You're really welcome. Of course, you shall know the truth. Mm-hmm. And the truth shall set you free. I'm seeing my brother Ernest peeping now. He can come in. I know there was a lot of traffic on the way. Yeah. Because even we thank God that we made it here in time. In fact, we left quite early. You know, we left quite early. So, you know, we had a lot of time to play with, but still it's good we left early, because we were actually stuck in traffic. So when I didn't see them, I said, they must have left at their normal time. We decided this time around to leave earlier than we normally do, and we came here in time. We thank God. Before we have started, they are already here, because it's always good to, you know, to sing worship and praise unto God. And I don't know if they have settled right now. My sister's smiling. Are they settled right now? Oh, do I hand over to them, or do I hand over to my sister or myself? She's sweating at sister show. Whichever one, we all sing it to the glory of God.
Amen.
So there's no problem about that. So if they're ready, yes, you know, you can go ahead.
We worship you, Son of God, you are so good, Almighty God, hallowed be your name, your dominion is forevermore, Adonai,
Adonai.
Worship you, Son of God.
our Lord is actually a holy, he's a holy God, and his name is holy. That's what the song means, if you don't understand. It said, holy, holy, holy. Holy is our God. Our God is a holy God. And the Bible said, be thou holy, even as I am holy. Praise the Lord. So we'll go quickly into what we have today because of the time. And today, because, you know, sometimes you wake up in the morning and, in fact, to tell you the truth, when I woke up in the morning today, I didn't even feel like going downstairs. I was just, you know, I wasn't physically tired, but, you know, I was just kind of drained, kind of, if I should put it that way. And, you know, when I went down, because my daughter, she didn't have a lecture today, so I was just saying, look, I have program today, and I just seem to be, like, kind of blank and whatever. And I don't even know what I'm going. And I just didn't have any. After a time, I said, no, let me just go and have my bath. Let me just do something with myself. Maybe I would. I just had my bath. I came down. As I dressed up early because my son, Minnie, came. I said, Mommy, you already dressed up? I said, yeah, that I might as well dress up and sit down and wait. Because, you know, I didn't know what again to do with myself. I said, I might as well sit down and wait. Before, I wanted to go to the church, but, I was getting phone calls from one thing or the other. Then, but as I sat down, I just said, okay, let me just sit down and just open my Bible. And as I was just turning the pages of my, of my notebook to get to a blank page to start writing, as I was just turning, I caught upon something. And the Spirit of God said, you preach about this. And I think it was some Sundays ago, God gave me this message to preach in church. And he said, share this message on air. And I said, okay, I was happy because as of that time, I didn't know whether I was coming or going. You know, sometimes people don't realize that even as a pastor, sometimes you actually just feel, you just want to just lie down and close your door and close your windows and just lie down on the bed and not see any person or talk with any person. We are all human beings. Sometimes some people treat us as if to say that we came from a special planet.
Superhuman.
It's really superhuman. You're not supposed to feel sad, or you're not supposed to feel tired or hungry or frustrated. Everything's supposed to be okay 24 hours of the day. It's not like that. Just what you feel sometimes. We feel it. Sometimes you get frustrated. Sometimes you just get fed up. Sometimes you just wake up in the morning. And I'm telling you, you just don't want to get up and go anywhere, even on a Sunday morning. It happens to us. But, you know, all those things are because we're what? We're human beings. And what happens is that it makes you even more dependent on God because you know that this is not something that you can do on your own. And God will always come through to you at the right time. Praise the Lord. So today I want us to look at, you know, a topic which I termed investment opportunities. You know, the first when I said it first in church, everybody was looking at me like, what on earth is this woman saying? Because it's not something that, of course, we preach in church. But it's from another angle. We're not talking about the investment of the world. We're not talking about, you know, once you hear investment, you're thinking about shares, you're thinking about stocks, you're thinking about, investing in maybe real estate or one thing or the other. We're not talking about that. Because God himself is the number one investor. He is the number one investor, and he sees opportunities everywhere. In fact, it's only God that can even open your eyes, our eyes, to where there's opportunity for investment. We won't even know, because God sees opportunity everywhere, and opportunities to invest. And when God is investing, he expects returns from his investment. Because what is an investment anyway? An investment is, to invest means to use what you have, your resources, your talents, your abilities, whatever it is that you have, in order to put into something with the expectation of what? Of a return. That's why when you put money inside a savings account, you're expecting what? A percentage of profits coming out from it. They're supposed to pay you certain amounts for that investment. If you invest in stocks, if you invest in shares, if you invest in the housing market, you're expecting at the end of the year, you will get what? A yield. But one thing you must understand is that the investment of the world is the investment of the world. But there's an investment that is in what? That is in the kingdom of God. And most of us don't realize that we can't say the kingdom of God just like that. If there's a kingdom, that means that there's certain things that can be invested in a kingdom. Just like you have United Kingdom. If you come to United Kingdom, there are things you can invest here. You go to other countries, there are things you can invest. So also in the kingdom of God, there are what? Investment opportunities. But sometimes we may not realize it as what? Investment opportunities. But the good thing with the investment into the kingdom of God has to do with the fact that you're sure that your investment will not be affected. Here you can invest in shares and stocks. If the stock market falls, that's it. Some people, millions of pounds, millions of naira, millions of whatever have been wiped off as a result of one crash or the other. Some people have bought houses when the market was really, really high. Now the value of those homes have gone down. But in the kingdom of God, it's not so. So what are these investment opportunities that will serve us not only here, but in heaven? What are those investment opportunities where we will get a return for our investment, not only in here, but in heaven? Because anything we are doing now, we should always think of the fact that it does not end here. One day we will all die, and we are going to a place. And when you get to that place, what are you going to see? It's what we invested here that we are going to enjoy in heaven. When we get to heaven, there's no opportunity again there for you to invest. It's what we invest now that we're going to what enjoy in heaven. We will enjoy our investment while we're still alive here, but we'll equally enjoy that investment in heaven. And I want us to do what? To think about that. Most of the time, we're only thinking about our immediate needs. Human beings are generally very what? Selfish and self-centered. Every person. It's only the Spirit of God that can cause us to remove our eyes from ourselves and realize that there's more to life than only we. We're only one person in the midst of over 7.7 billion people. It's only you. But we are behaving as if it's only me. But when we remove our eyes enough from ourselves, we will find out that there are opportunities everywhere that will cause a return on our investments, spiritually, physically, and financially, here and in heaven. Praise the Lord. So there's the first investment that we're going to, you know, talk about has to do with what? With winning souls. Some of us don't realize that to win a soul is what? Is an investment. There are people whose families have become born again as a result of the fact that they themselves have been investing in the lives of other people. Just as the book, you know, Joshua, the book of Joshua 24, Joshua said that as far as I and my household, we shall do what? Serve the Lord. And the Bible equally says that God will save us and what? Our household what? As well. So Joshua was very sure, because as far as he was concerned, all his household was what? Was saved. So they will serve the Lord, because God promised that he will save us and our households as well. You find out that most of the time, it's not even by talking to your family members. In fact, because they know you when you are growing up, if you are talking about anything, they won't even want to listen. I say, please go. They will now remind you when you used to steal meat from the pot of soup. Or when everybody else is going to school, you hide by the way. When everybody passes to school, you go and begin to play in one place or the other. They will remind you. You understand? They will remind you about so many things that you used to do. So most of the time, it's not even your direct talking to your family members that will cause them to repent. But God will cause other people to talk to them as a result of you investing in the lives of other people and drawing them unto Christ. Because what? It is a what? An investment. And not only will you get that reward of having your family members being saved, you will get other rewards as well, because what is what? An investment. Even when trouble wants to come or certain things will come, because of what you're doing in the lives of people, God will not allow certain things to come your way, because he knows how important you are to, you know, people who are not saved. And when we talk about winning souls, it's not only winning somebody who doesn't even know Christ at all. There are people who have backslidden. There are people who, they may not have backslidden, but they don't know their left or their right concerning the things of God. And a lot of them are into one mistake or the other. When you turn them away from what? Destruction. You're actually winning them away from the kingdom of darkness. You don't need to know the Bible from Genesis to Revelation. Even your testimony can cause people to do what? To come unto Christ. Can cause people to change. Their lives will change for the better as a result of your testimony. So when the Bible says winning, you know, we should win souls, that is what? An investment. My sister, please read Proverbs 11, verse 30.
Proverbs 11.
Yes,
30.
Yes.
The fruit of the righteous is a tree of life.
Yes.
And he that winneth souls is wise.
Said the fruit of the righteous is a tree of life. And he that winneth souls is what? Is wise. God links winning of souls to what? Wisdom. He said that person has what? Wisdom. You're a wise person. Any person that makes that effort to draw other people unto Christ, to turn people from their evil ways. Sometimes we see people doing things that are wrong. We ignore them. We don't bother. We just ignore them. It may not even be the day you talk to someone and the person will you know, will change. But anytime you tell somebody something, you have planted what? A seed. The person may even scoff at you, but that seed is there. And one day, that seed will germinate. And one day, when it begins to grow and germinate, just another word from another person is enough for the person to realize, look, I have to what? Make a change in my life. And change comes. It happened to all of nobody was born again in the womb. Or not letting that anybody change their characteristics from the time they were in the womb. Change is an ongoing thing. So there are things, you have opportunities everywhere. Even when you go to buy things in the market, even when you go to do your hair, you don't need to be on television or preach on the pulpits before you win souls. The person you see every day, just one word or the other, even sharing your testimony, you have done something, you have said something to the person. In the supermarket, at the supermarket counter, somebody if you go to a particular supermarket all the time, somebody makes at the count, at the, you know, checkout, may notice, anytime I see this person, they're always cheerful. One day, they may even ask you, why are you always so happy? And then you can use that opportunity to tell them why you're so happy. So there's so many ways, but it is an investment. You are not wasting your time, you're not wasting any person's time. You're doing something for your future, not only here, but in heaven. My sister, please, can you read Daniel chapter 12, verse 3?
Daniel
12, verse 3.
Daniel 12, verse 3.
Yes.
And they that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever.
It's just saying the same thing. They that be wise shall shine as the brightness of the firmament, and they that turn many to righteousness as the stars forever and ever. So those who turn people from what? Unrighteousness to righteousness, from evil to good, from darkness to light, they shall be like what? The stars that shine in the firmament for what? Forever. Make an effort. Don't just see things and do what? Ignore it. For us to make a change, we must, you know, start from one person. Like I said, you don't need a whole crowd. One person is enough for you to say something, and the person will do what? Will change. One advice. Some people are even crying out. By their very behavior, they are crying out for somebody who would tell them you're doing something wrong. Some of us don't even know that. You don't think the person is just misbehaving. The person is just misbehaving to get attention, so that somebody somewhere will say, come, don't you know that what you're doing is wrong? And you'll be surprised. There are people you talk to that you think will listen to you. You begin to talk to them, their ears are open to hear you, and they will thank you for talking to them. But the way they were behaving initially, you'd be like, if I just talk to this one, I don't know what they're going to do to me. Some people are looking for who will tell them the truth, who will be a help to them, and turn them away from what? From their wicked ways. Some people are not enjoying what they are doing, but they are yet to see somebody who will encourage them to change and be a supportive factor for them to, you know, turn away from that error. So don't just see people I ignore and just, well, that's their own. It's, you know, here in this society, it's like everybody minds their own business. But that's why sometimes you like Nigeria, we poke our noses too much. And sometimes that poking our noses, it actually has saved a lot of people. But I didn't say that you should become a nuisance, but at least you become what? A help to somebody. Praise the Lord. And then finally, my sister, James 5:20. Excuse me. I hope you can read that, or do I read that for you? James chapter 5, verse 20.
Okay, James 5, 20.
Yes.
Let him know that he which converteth the sinner from the error of his way shall save his soul from death, and shall hide a multitude of sins.
Praise the Lord. So it's just the same thing. It's just to give another scripture to show you how important it is to God for us to be concerned about what is going on in the lives of, you know, other people. When we see error, when we see sin in our lives, in the lives around us, because it is an investment. There are things that you do, there are things that happen in your life that you begin to wonder even to yourself. I can't remember praying about this thing, but it's like this kind of a blessing, this kind of a favor. There are things that we do that we don't even realize that it's what is bringing the blessing into our life. We may not have prayed for that blessing or for that open door, but somehow you find out that there are certain things in your life that change, not because you remember any time you prayed. once you invest in certain things in the kingdom of God, God will make what? An investment in your life. Like I said earlier, God is the ultimate investor. The Bible, if you go to the Bible in the book of Genesis chapter 1, from verse 1 to 3, it says that in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. And verse 2, it says that you know, the earth was without form, without void, and darkness covered what? The face of the deep. And the Spirit of the Lord hovered over the surface of the deep. And in verse 3, the Bible said that God said, let there be light, and there was light. God didn't see the darkness. He didn't see the formlessness, the voidness, the emptiness, and say, well, there's nothing I can do with this. God sees opportunities where you and I may not see. A lot of every day of our life, there's always an opportunity to do what? To invest in something. But most of the time, we are too concerned about ourselves that we don't see it. Another person may have seen darkness, but God saw what? An opportunity for what? For light to come forth. And he said, let there be light. And of course, there was light. Amen. Even if you think about the story of David in the book of 1 Samuel, we won't read it. When there was a time for another king to be ordained because of Saul's sin, his own father, his own brothers did not see anything in him. Samuel came and said, look, I'm coming to, you know, anoint one of your sons because God has chosen one of your sons. And Jesse must have just immediately, you know, just assumed that it can't be, I mean, why would I bother going to call David? It'll be one of my other sons. But he didn't know that person that they despised, that person they disdained, that person they disregarded, that person they didn't even see anything good, that God has seen what and what? An investment opportunity. Mm. And he picked up that David and he put him what? On the throne. And David became the greatest king in Israel. That even when Jesus came, he was being called what? The son of what? David. But what people didn't, what his family didn't see, God saw. So we need to pray to that God will open our eyes to what? Investment opportunities that can bring us what? A return. In the book of John chapter 3, verse 16, the Bible says that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That whoever believeth in him will not perish but have everlasting life. He invested Jesus Christ, and today he has what? Reaped, you know, millions and billions of souls who have given their lives to Christ from one word, investment. Another set of people another area where there's, you know, there's investment opportunities is in the life of widows. One thing I've noticed is when you sow into the life of a widow, you get immediate blessing.
That's true.
Because their husbands are dead, so God is their father. And usually, unfortunately, widows tend to be maltreated. I mean, here, they may not go through a lot of things that people back home go through. But still, there's a lot of loneliness. There are people that once they become widows, even their former family friends don't even bother about them anymore. There's some people, when they are widows, they wouldn't want, you know, when they become widows, their friends, you know, kind of push them aside. Mm. They don't want to come near them because they feel that if we visit them, some of them will want to steal our husbands from us. It's true. So you see some widows who will be telling you, see, this is my friend, our family friend, they don't come anymore. Because they feel that maybe if they keep on coming, one day I and their husband will begin to have a relationship. Most people don't even bother or think too much about them. Even if they have the money to take care of themselves, some of them are very, very lonely. Especially when their children grow up and go leave the house. So when you invest in the life of a widow, it is what? It is an investment that will yield what? Will yield returns. Because God has special care for the widows. His eye especially what? Is on the widows. And when you now what? Do something for them, God will see it and he will do what? He will reward you. There are things that happen in our life that, like I said earlier, you don't know why those blessings are coming in your life. You may not even know because you cannot remember a time you actually knelt down and said, God, I want this. But there are certain things you have been doing. In fact, there are some certain people that what is protecting them is what they've been doing for other people. And they may not even know. Some people may say, do you know, I don't know what happened though. In fact, I don't know how God just delivered me from this situation. They don't know because they don't realize what happened. In the book of Matthew chapter 25, I think from verse 30 or 31 down, when the Bible was talking about judgment, say that when we appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that God, Jesus is going to separate between the goats and the what? And the sheep. And then those who are the sheep, he will say, when I was hungry, you fed me. When I was thirsty, you gave me drink. When I was in prison, you visited me. And so on and so forth. And they'll be asking him, when did we see you hungry? He said that as long as you did it to the least of my brethren, you have done it what? Unto me. So what am I telling you? That there are things that have brought you blessing. You may not even know. You don't even, like they didn't even know that it was the thing that they did that caused Jesus to say that when I was hungry. And that's what they were asking him. When were you hungry? When were you thirsty? So there are blessings that will come your way. There are protections that will come your way. There's a favor that will come your way. You may not even remember. But there are certain things you must have done that God has seen. And one of them is when you take care of what? Of widows. You have widows in your family. You may have an auntie, some aunties, or somebody near. Even if there's only one person that you decide, okay, let me bless that person. Because there's always what? A return. There's a particular family friend of ours. Anytime we give this woman money, immediately, not even, you know, later, immediately the money comes back one way or the other. And you find out that, and we begin to notice anytime you give any widow anything, anytime you give them anything, something immediately, they say, like, somebody somewhere will, God will cause that person to bless you. Something will always happen. Identify some people in your life, in your family, around you that you know that are widows. Even if you feel they can take care of themselves, and put something into their hands. Call them up. It may not even be money. Investing in them doesn't necessarily mean you must give them money. If you don't have to give them, but you can call them up to find out how they are. There was a woman of God I used to visit then in Nigeria. And you know, I would go, but she would keep me for sometimes 2-3 hours. I realized she was lonely. And she was a widow. All the children had left the house. You know, so I would, you know, visit her, we would talk 1 hour, 2 hours. You know, you could see that she was really needed the company. And I didn't mind. We would talk and talk. She's well-to-do, so she didn't lack for anything. So some people may have felt that, well, she has a lot of money because she was really well-to-do. Her husband was really well-to-do, so, you know, she had a lot. But you could see that she was a lonely woman. She was actually lonely. So put a smile on the face of a widow, and it is what? An investment. It's not until you go and buy 20 houses and all of them are mortgaged. And when the market drops, the people who, the banks that have the houses will come and take it back from you. No. But invest in something, because we don't realize that these things are what? Investments, what? Opportunities. My sir, please read James chapter 1, verse 27. James 1, 27.
James 1, 27.
Yes.
Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this: to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction, and to keep himself unspotted from the world.
He said, pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this. Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father. Because that is the person we are seeking to please, not the world. Before God and the Father is to visit the fatherless and the widows in their affliction. That is one thing that is very, very what? Important to God. So make an effort. There must be somebody you know, even in your family. Don't think that whatever you want to give them or do for them is small. They will appreciate it, because it's not even the amount, but the fact that you actually remember them. Some people are not even thinking about how much you give them, but that you actually remember them. And it touches them. And the prayer of a widow goes straight to God, because God is their husband. So it goes straight. There's nothing that is, you know, blocking it. Straight to God. That is why once you invest in a widow, whether it's your time, whether it's your effort, whether it's your finances, you get immediate what? Return. Immediate, not later. Immediate return. In the book of Acts of the Apostles, chapter 9, verse 39 to 40, we'll not read it because of time, because I want to go to another of the areas. That was had to do with Dorcas. When Dorcas was sick, she became sick and she died. And when Peter came, all the widows were there crying. Why? Because they said that they were showing Peter all the clothes that Dorcas had sold for them. Say, look at Dorcas, it's Dorcas, because she was known to do what? To help the widows. She was known to do what? To give them food, to sew clothes for them, to visit them, to help them. So they began to cry. I said, look at, the person that was helping us, the person that was blessing us, the person that remembered us, is now dead. Peter had to go and pray. He had to pray. And God raised that up. How won't God raise that up when all the widows are there crying? There are people that have made themselves so important that even when the devil attacks them, God has to what? Intervene and drag them out of what? The, you know, the hands of the devil. Because there are so many people that are going to be affected if they go. Dorcas was one of them. Why can't we be one of them who will affect people's life in such a way that even if the devil comes, they will say, look, God, if anything happens to this person, you know that we are finished. I'm sure that they said, you know we are finished. It's only she that remembers also. It's only she that remembers that we have to eat. It's only she that remembers that we need to be blessed. You had better keep this Dorcas. And God answered what? That prayer. That is what? An investment opportunity. Because of time, we cannot. I will call on my sister. I'm sure that she will know one. She will give us. She said, And tomorrow, and on Saturday, we'll continue. Yes. I took you by surprise, did I? I took
so
you by surprise.
What am I expected today?
Yeah, give us another investment opportunity. I've talked about winning souls, okay. And I've talked about widows.
Okay. Well, I think, you know, it's all in the same line, you know, as to what you've just said.
Yes.
You know, there are other people, the down and outs in the society. You know, the destitutes, the lepers, ex-prisoners, you know, people who, you know, left to the society, nobody would have remembered them. So I think if one could go that extra mile to, you know, lend a helping hand or to even recognize them in some way, that's an investment opportunity.
Of course, that's a very good one. The poor, the Bible says in the book of, I think, Psalm 41 from verse 1, it says that blessed is he that considered the poor. The Bible said that God will do what? Deliver him on what? On the bed of what? Sickness. And that God will not deliver him into the will of what? His enemies. So he said, those who consider what? The poor. The poor are not only those who are financially poor. Those who come out from prison, they are poor socially because they are treated like outcasts. It doesn't mean that, I mean, when people come out from prison, I mean, we're not talking about, some people just feel that they went to prison, so why should I even bother? But they become a menace to the society again because nobody is there to what? Help them. So why don't you help them? They've come out. Why don't you help? Why don't you? Now they're outcasts. There are people who have been in prison before, but God has what? Reformed.
It's true.
And they have become what? A blessing. Like I said, you may see only darkness, but God sees what? Opportunity. Let us see opportunity. So those ones are poor socially. Then you have the destitute. Why I called my sister, I'm sure, because I took her by surprise. Because there was something she told me, what she used to do before. She would cook food and go and give to, you know, where they share food to the homeless people. And she was telling me until they, you know, they stopped that. That they stopped allowing people to give food to homeless people. There's some people, that's the only food, the hot food they will eat for that day. That's the only hot food they will eat for that day. I was watching Panorama some months ago, and what I saw was so sad. This man was once an investment banker. He made a lot of money, but when the stock market crashed, he lost. He was sleeping in the park. Somebody who had a lot before, he was sleeping in the park. So it was these people that bring food, you know, to the homeless and the destitute. They used to come around, I think, 8 o'clock in the night. Yes. Then he would now go, and that will be his first hot meal for that day. It is what? An investment. I have to stop here now so that I can open the lines. On Saturday, by God's grace, we will conclude this topic because there are so many areas. Honoring your father and your mother is an investment. The Bible says that so that your days may be long in the land that the Lord has given you. So this is the first commandment with what? Promise. Some of us don't honor our parents. We don't honor people who have, some people have stood as our father and our mother. There are people that you know that, in fact, what they have done for you, your own parents couldn't have done for you. They have done a lot for you. Do you honor them? It's an investment. When you honor them, the Bible says your days shall be what? Long in the land that God what? Giveth unto you. And when God talked about length of days, it's not just how long, but the quality of life. You will get quality of life when you what? Invest in your parents. The prayer alone that they will pray for you will reach heaven what? One way. Because they, my son, my daughter, what they did. And so many areas, we will deal with all these things by God's grace on Saturday so that we can look around and realize too that it's not just, you know, just running around looking for how you're going to solve this, your problem or solve that problem. Look, will cause a return in your life, in Jesus' name. Okay, we have a caller. Hello, blessing from Holland.
Hello, Pastor. Good evening, ma.
Good evening, my sister. God bless you.
Yeah, I thank God for how he has been using you to preach the good gospel, even your husband.
Amen.
We are blessed, and even today's message, we thank God for everything.
Amen.
Amen. Pastor, please, I'm calling especially for my son. He's almost getting to 4 years old now, and he hardly makes a sentence. And the school now, they are getting worried. They are even placing him on special therapy, on how to talk and other things. And right now, he's sick. He hardly eats. He's just lean, you know. Maybe because of the not eating good, he usually catches sickness and other things. So please, ma, I would like you to help me to pray for him that God will touch him, that there will be a massive change in his speech and also in his health.
I believe God will do that in Jesus. I will pray for your son.
Amen.
But I want you to pray for him. I want you to lay hands on him. And every day, pray and decree the word of God. Why? Because you're his mother.
Yeah.
And mothers have authority. But I will pray. Father, I lift up before you your son into your hands. And I bind every spirit of deaf and dumb operating in his life right now. And I command that spirit of deaf and dumb to come out of his life right now in the mighty name of Jesus. Any evil, any hand, anything has ever touched his tongue for evil or touched his throat for evil, I command that thing to be destroyed in the mighty name of Jesus. I command his tongue to be loosened, and I command every infirmity in his life to be paralyzed in the mighty name of Jesus. There surely is a change in Jesus' name. Amen. Hello, caller.
Hello.
Hello, Chinedu from London.
Hello, good evening, ma'am.
Good evening, my brother. Go ahead.
I'm blessed by your message.
We thank God.
I just want your advice, ma, please.
Yes.
I've been a blessing to my mother back home.
Yes.
And I've for every pin or for every you know pen that I've got here, I've really worked so hard to make sure my mother is fine.
Yes.
But to my surprise, in all honesty.
Yes.
You know. My mother comes back to tell me, because my wife, I'm here with my wife, and when I just, upon the blessing that I'm giving to my mother, she tells me one day I'm going to carry my hand on my head. You know, sometimes we will bless my, when I bless my mother with something, you know, with gifts of cash and all that, she tells people I don't bless her. I'm not happy about it, and I just want to seek about you're a mother as well.
I will give you advice concerning that, because if the Bible says honor your father and your mother.
Yes, ma'am.
And the Bible doesn't give a distinction to the good ones and the bad ones. There are some who are problematic. What you need to do too is before you give your mother a gift, pray over it. Just pray over it pray that she'll never use it for evil against you. That's what you will pray, and you give it to her. But keep on blessing her, because it's a command from God. But make sure you pray over your blessing and pray that she will never use it against you, because some mothers do that, whether we like it or not. Pray over it, and you'll find out that things will change in your life.
Thank you, ma'am.
In Jesus' name.
And one more thing, ma'am.
Yes.
When I came here,
yes.
My father is late, actually.
Yes.
But before my father died, that was back home in Nigeria, he blessed me. He blessed me so much, and when I came here, the land opened for me.
Yes.
Whatever I touched here was progressing.
Yes.
When I came here, as I was sitting, when I was blessing my mother,
yes.
Some people came to her and said, how come people come here and they don't progress that much? How can this boy just come here and things are making way for him?
Yes.
And they said he's doing 419. And my mother was, she appeared supporting those people that that I'm doing 419.
No, that's what I'm telling. That's what I'm telling you. You pray before you give her anything. You pray, and don't allow what other people are saying to have anywhere that, in fact, anywhere any person is making any evil pronouncement against you concerning your blessing. Let that which they're making, let it go back to them in Jesus' name. Amen. Hello, Ukamaka from Ireland. Sorry for keeping you waiting. Hello.
Good evening, Pastor.
Good evening, my sister.
Yeah, Pastor, I want to thank God for your life and for the life of your husband.
Amen.
Yeah, Pastor, anytime you pray for me, things happen. You are a real woman of God.
We thank God.
Yeah. Pastor, please, I want you to pray for my mom. She's been having pain from her legs. Please, I want you to use the veto power as a woman and as a mother to pray for her. Anytime she calls and complains, I feel concerned.
No, of course, definitely. I will pray for your mother. My prayer for her is that every spirit of infirmity affecting her legs, I bind that spirit and I command it back to the senders in the mighty name of Jesus. Whatever it is she has stepped on, whatever the enemy has kept for her that she has stepped on that is affecting her legs, my prayer today is that let the fire of God uproot every implantation, every poison in her legs. Let them be uprooted and be destroyed, even right now, in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we know that distance is not a barrier to you, and we pray that, Lord God, that your healing power will flow upon her legs, even right now. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Yes, hello, caller. I think I missed two callers because of the other caller that was on the line for a long time. Please, we are sorry about that. Still try to call in. And you get through in Jesus' name. Hello, Linda from Holland.
Yeah, hello.
Yes, can you speak up? I can't hear you well.
Yeah, hello, Pastor.
Yeah, God bless you, my sister.
Yeah, God bless you too. I thank you very much for this program. You people have been doing it. It has really been a blessing in my life.
Amen.
And I appreciate everything you continue to do. But I want you to pray for me. Because I've been in Holland for the past 17 years. Things are not working well for me. My papers and things are not.
My dear, you have to speak up. Your voice keeps on going low. I can't hear you so well.
Yeah, I've been here for the past 15 to 17 years.
Yes.
And things are not working well for me. My papers and my son is also autistic. So I need you to pray for me so that things will work good for me. I went to the Antwerp
a program, okay.
Yeah, the last. That was the. They said that was the end of it.
Yes.
But I'm praying. I know your husband prayed for me, and I'm hoping that things will turn up in Jesus' name.
Of course, God will do a thing. You shouldn't be hoping, you should be believing. I believe that God has started a new thing in your life in the name of Jesus. My prayer is that whatever is standing before you, use Joshua 1:5. Say, no man can stand before you all the days of your life. Whatever is standing against your progress, I command them to be uprooted right now in the mighty name of Jesus. Whatever has been standing as a hindrance, as an obstruction in your life, today those things are destroyed in Jesus' name. Amen. Hello, Peter. Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, God bless you. Please go ahead.
Yeah, good evening, madam.
Good evening, my brother.
Yeah, I just want to thank you for your message.
Yeah.
I've got a little word regarding the message.
Yes.
Yeah, my sister was a widow.
Yes.
Yeah, but I and my wife, we brought her to the country to come and help us out to take care of the baby. But eventually she came, but she didn't do what we asked her to do. So she said she wants to go and earn extra money. So she left. We helped her eventually because she was a widow.
Yes.
But eventually she's like, she has a lot of needs. That's why she can't stay with us. So she went to source for money.
Yeah.
But we tried our best, but she went. We begged her to stay, but she left. So when you were saying about widow, that we should help widows, I took that because even back home when I was still
I have to cut you off a bit. I'm sorry, because there are other people waiting. But what I want to say here is that whatever it is that we, you know, we're supposed to do, you do it not because of the person. If you begin to do things for the because of the person, we will not do it. Still help widows, whether they are grateful or not. Just do what God told you to do and be prayerful about it so that they will not use it against you. That's all. If you keep on looking at what people are doing to us, we will not help any person. Praise the Lord. Hello, Ekwi from Italy.
Hello, good evening, ma.
Good evening, my sister. Please go ahead.
May God bless you, ma.
God bless you too, my sister.
Ma, please, I want you to pray for me because of my son. He's not feeling fine.
What's wrong with him?
He has a fever.
He has fever. Have you taken him to hospital?
Yes, I've taken him to hospital. But all the same. They've done different tests, but nothing. They're not seeing anything.
No problem. Since you have taken him to hospital, the hospital has done their own. God will do his own. Father, I lift up before you your son into your hand. Every spirit of affliction afflicting his body, I bind that spirit of affliction and I command it to go back to their sender in the mighty name of Jesus. Any affliction, any infirmity that has been directed against this boy, I paralyze it in his body right now in the mighty name of Jesus. And I speak healing from the throne room of God, that the healing power of God will flow through his body even right now. And that fever will immediately be dispelled in the mighty name of Jesus. In fact, I pray too that anywhere that the enemy is cooking any pot and calling his name, and in order to project that fever against him, let that pot be shattered right now in the mighty name of Jesus. And I command that fever to leave him. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Hello, Modupe from London.
Hello, good evening.
Good evening, my sister.
Yes, ma. I just want to say thank you for everything you've been saying. Amen. All your preaching yesterday, today, everything was so actually... It's like you actually opening my eyes, most especially the one for today about widow. It's actually you opening my eyes to see what like it's like a stumbling block, which I know and I believe God has actually removed everything now.
Amen.
And I know that by the time you pray for me, a prayer of agreement, that everything that I lays my hand upon will be prosper in the name of Jesus. I just want to help me with a prayer.
I will pray with you. The Bible says that whatever we lay our hands to do, we shall prosper. That is the word of God, and that word is settled in heaven. It is settled in heaven forever. Therefore, anything you set your hands to do, God will cause you to prosper in the name of Jesus. I pray that the favor of God and man shall be with you in the mighty name of Jesus. We have run out of time, so we have to close. But my prayer is that God will open your eyes. And as you invest, the blessing of God will come upon you more and more in the name of Jesus. Remember, tomorrow's program, it starts tomorrow, part of our crusade. Make sure you are there and God will bless you in Jesus' name. See you on Saturday as I hand over to my sister and my brother. God bless you.